Good afternoon to all delegates, guests, for this 3 days international webinar on artificial intelligence and machine learning, organized by JSPM's Jaywant Institute of Management Studies, NAC accredited A grade college. I, Professor Deepak Pinta, thank you all for joining us from all across the globe. We have got a great response for this webinar. We have received near about 1500 registrations all across the globe from different domains like academics, research, and industry. We have received these locations from all across globe. Some of the locations from where we have received these registrations are Turkey, Kenya, and Australia. During these 3 days, we have eminent speakers from various domains such as industry, academics, and research. These eminent speakers will share their knowledge in the field of artificial intelligence and machine learning. The webinar would give an insight of the artificial intelligence and machine learning and how tremendously it has increased the computing in various domains. Now, without further ado, I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Utku Kose. Welcome, sir. Dr. Kose has received his MS degree from Efyon University, Turkey. He has also received his PhD degree from Silik University, Turkey, in the field of computer engineering. He has worked as a research assistant in Efyon University. Currently, he is working as associate professor in Süleyman Demirel University, Turkey. He has published more than 100 national and international journals in various renowned sectors. He has also edited and authored many books and reports. Research area include artificial intelligence, machine ethics, artificial intelligence safety, distance education, e-learning, and many more. We are lucky enough to have Dr. Kose as a speaker for today's webinar. We are pleased to have Dr. Ravi Joshi, sir, Director, JSPM Group of Institutes, with us. Dr. Ravi Joshi, sir, is a person who is associated with JSPM since its inception. Under his dynamic leadership, JSPM has a lot of achievements and success story. I request Dr. Ravi Joshi, sir, to share his views about the webinar. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon to all of you. Dr. Utku Kose from Turkey, Priyanka Singh Madam, Director, the Jaywant Institute of Management, Deepak Pandita Pore, who is the coordinator of this webinar, and all the delegates. So I am Dr. Ravi Joshi, as he said, the Director for Planning and Development of the Jaywant Sikshan Prasarak Mandal. It's an umbrella which was established in the year 2001 by a founder, Dr. T.J. Sawant, who himself is an engineer belonging to a rural Maharashtra. So he came down to Pune, education hub of the country, in search of basically a job. And then he joined in one of the engineering colleges as an assistant professor. And slowly during his course of working there, somehow he had an ambition that somewhere to start an organization to cater to the students who are coming from the rural Maharashtra, to provide them a competent technical education at an affordable cost. That was his vision when he opened up his first institute in 2001. It was an engineering college. In fact, I too happened to be one of a faculty member who joined that college in the year 2001. Today, we are completing 20 years of this organization. So under our umbrella, we have almost 8 engineering colleges, more than 5 pharmacy institutes. There are MBA institutes, MCA institutes, and there are DEd and BEd, that is teachers training colleges, polytechnics, and plus schools also. So there are almost 50,000 students studying across these various branches in various parts of Pune. We have 6 campuses, one in out of Pune also. But all these campuses have a sort of a cluster. So each cluster has an engineering college, an MBA, MCA, and a school, polytechnics and pharmacy, so that in itself it can be a very small university in future if the time demands it. So with that intention, we are going about establishing the colleges. So all our colleges are almost in the process of it. So not only the quantity, it is the quality that matters for us too. Most of all the colleges have gone through a NAC accreditation program. Some of them have got their NBA accreditation. So one way or the other, so we are accredited by the accrediting agencies of India. So in this way, we are trying to establish ourselves as a major educational providers in the state of Maharashtra. Coming down to the organization of today, which is hosting a webinar today, Jaivant Institute of Management Studies. We established in the year 2004, and it is doing extremely well, as said, with the faculty, with the students coming out, with the entrepreneurial ability of the students, which is being developed in the institutes with the cooperation of the faculty as well as the director. The forward-looking approach, which the director madam has shown, that means it has transformed this institute into one of the leading management education providers of Pune. So without, as I said, I belong to a civil engineering fraternity, a little away from your artificial intelligence and machine learning. But nevertheless, these are the areas, these are the buzzwords, and they're going to catch up soon with all other branches of engineering also. So I wish all of you, all the delegates also, a very fruitful webinar, and so that they will be open for an enlightened discussion, and with the under the able guidance of Dr. Utku Kose. I welcome you again, sir, on this occasion, and I hand over the mic. Deepak Pandita.
Thank you very much, dear professor. Let's start if you desire, or dear professor Pandita.
Thank you, Joshi sir, for your valuable words of wisdom. Now proceeding further, I would request our director ma'am, Dr. Priyanka Singh, to kindly say some few words.
Yes. A very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I greet all of you on behalf of Jaivant Institute of Management Studies for today's 3 days seminar. Today is the introductory day, the first day. On behalf of entire JSPM fraternity, I thank Dr. Utku Kose for accepting our invitation and sharing his valuable thoughts and his guiding our audience for it. Special thanks to our JSPM Founder Secretary, Dr. T.J. Sawant sir, and Dr. R.S. Joshi sir, who are always there as pillars for us. We are very happy to share that we have got 1,560 participants from across the globe, people from Tanzania, people from Bangladesh, New Zealand, US. They have approached, they have registered. They will be getting e-certificate for this particular webinar. So without wasting much of your time, let us start with day one. And there is a comment section where the audience can post their queries, the question answers, which can be taken up at the end of the session. Over to you, Dr. Deepak Pandita.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for your words of appreciation. Now, I would request our chief, the speaker for day one, Dr. Utku Kose, to start with the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, dear professor. First of all, I would like to thank the director, dear Dr. Singh, and JSPM's JIMS for their kind invitation for such a valuable webinar sessions and series. And it's a pleasure for me to start that the webinar sessions with the starting point based on the AI and machine learning subjects. I hope everybody joined our session will enjoy that. I will open everybody's minds, or at least try to open everybody's mind to learn more about AI and machine learning, and also deep learning, of course. I hope everybody will enjoy. And I would like to also thank to Dr. Professor Pandita and also Professor Joshi for their kind introduction, and also especially valuable words by Professor Joshi about AI and machine learning. And I will take the control, and let's see if I can open your mind more and more. And so welcome to the world of the AI and machine learning, and let's move. I will share my screen first of all. If you, if anybody encounter about hearing me or seeing me, just let me know. I'm also tracking the session from the YouTube channel, so I'm just sharing my screen. Yes, I think my screen is visible now. Yes. I've just titled my presentation as the Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning with Current and Future State. As you know, that's the field is very important. It has a very great impact on especially current solutions for real world problems. And also it has a very big potential for the future state of the humankind and the world. So we should examine its, first of all, current state, discuss some or introduce some about the essential techniques that they are widely used in the terms of AI and machine learning. And we should also, of course, discuss something regarding the near and far future. So let's start. I would like to again thank to the kind invitation by GSPM's Jayavant Institute of Management Studies. It's a great for me to with everybody here. I don't know the exact number, but it may be more than 5 or 6 to realize an event with the collaboration with India. So thank you very much for the, everybody in India for following me and also giving such opportunities to share my knowledge and also share our ideas in such online webinar sessions. So I'd like to see more, and if anybody want to ask anything, just you can ask me at the end of my presentation. But not only presentation, you can also follow my email address, and also you can visit my website with my name and .com, and you are all free to reach to me to ask anything you want to know about AI and its multidisciplinary applications especially. Yes, in my presentation I will just start with what is the artificial intelligence, by explaining what is artificial intelligence and asking that question and just giving some answers from different perspectives. And after that I will consider the subfields of artificial intelligence and also explain briefly some essential techniques of artificial intelligence and machine learning. By making that, I will try to explain the main differences between, for example, intelligent optimization or machine learning, and also differences in terms of machine learning and deep learning. So everybody asking such questions, what is AI, what is ML or DL, there are lots of concepts maybe you want to learn more about. So I will try to explain all of them. And also after that, I will just focus on how we apply AI techniques and AI-based systems in present problems, in especially real-world problems. And after that, I will explain some about some new concepts and also some future perspectives regarding the near and far future of AI. And also after that, I will explain some open problems because I know there are lots of researchers and also valuable students who are looking for more research opportunities in near or far future. So I will try to explain some open problems which you may follow in the following period. After that, I will also give, especially to our valuable students, some suggestions how to move to learn more about AI and associated the subjects. And at the end, I will take all of your questions. Before starting, just professors also introduced me very kindly, so you can see my short bio as expressed before. But I would like to also add my academic profiles. You can visit to learn what I'm doing in terms of research and what types of papers or academic and scientific studies I'm currently running. So you are all free to visit my academic profiles and also my personal website for more news and also I've just updated my personal website to write some blog texts in the near future. So you can follow my personal webpage especially. And you are also also free to reach to me, contact to me, as I've said before. And let me to explain something about our country and my cities. I'm currently working and my hometown, of course. As the professor also said that I'm from the Süleyman Demirel University from Department of Computer Engineering. And that university is located, that public university is located in the city of Isparta, as you can see from the red square located over that city. And also I'm I was born in the Afyon, Karahisar, Afyon or shortly, which is my hometown. And I have been working as the research assistant at the start of my academic career in Afyon. And after that, I moved to Uşak, as you can see on the west side of Afyon. And after that, in around 2017, I moved to Sparta. I start as the assistant professor. And after that, in near to end of the 2019, I became an associate professor. So as you can see, I'm already working around that area, but you are all free to visit our beautiful country, especially the seaside sections, seaside regions. You can see lots of places. For example, we are just 1.5 hour to Antalya, which is very beautiful city. You may already heard about that. And also you may already, of course, everybody should have heard about Istanbul. But the Turkey is not just Istanbul. There are lots of cities, and you are all welcome to visit our country. And of course, you are also welcome to visit our city, Sparta, where I am currently working. Our city, Sparta, is especially famous with its roses. So that explains why there is a rose logo over the logo of our university. As you can see, we are also in the region with lots of lakes. We have, for example, such a beautiful town called as Eğirdir here. And you are all welcome to visit Sparta, visit me, visit our department, of course. And also you are all free to or welcome to visit my hometown, Afyon. It has some castles, as you can see. It's very important on especially independence wars of Turkey. So you are all welcome to visit both cities. And also let me to explain some briefly about our department and also our university. As you can see, there is the logo. There is the rose logo over the university logo. And the Süleyman Demirel is one of the previous presidents of the Turkish of Turkey Republic. So he was also born in Sparta, and that explains why we have his name in the name of our university. Our university is a public university, is located in Sparta, Turkey, and as established in 1992, we have around 70,000 students. So we can say that the Süleyman Demirel University is a large academic institution in Turkey, and we are known with our programs in agricultural research, medicine, engineering, and also business science. And when we come to our Department of Computer Engineering, we have three professors currently and one associate professor, which is me, of course, and we have also 9 assistant professors and 2 research assistants working in 3 different areas of computer science, computer software, and computer hardware. I'm also in the computer science area of our department, and we have the Baccalaureate of Science, Master of Science, and PhD degrees. We also host lots of international students, so you are all welcome to get some degree in our university. You are all welcome to visit our university to learn more about the procedures. So you are all welcome to visit Sparta and, of course, our university and our department. Yes, let's start. We should ask, first of all, what is AI? In order to understand what is about what types of research is currently running in terms of AI and what types of research that may be run or will probably run in the future, we should first of all learn about what is AI. AI is something or somehow a simulation of humans, animals, and the nature. As you know, there are lots of techniques, or I can say that there are lots of hundreds of maybe techniques which are especially inspired from the nature, from the human, and also animals. We can just briefly say that it's all inspiration from the nature. And we can say that the AI, the field of AI, is just a technology-based intelligence solutions. It's a collection of intelligence solutions which are running different types of technology components. I can say that especially rise of the computer and communication technologies, and also rise of the associated technologies such as cloud computing or, for example, other electronics based developments have caused the field of AI to gain more momentum in especially last period of the 20th century. And after the 21st century, after the start of that century, we already have that the intelligent the science and the field of that intelligent solutions in our daily life. So we can say that it's associated with lots of supportive technologies, and it just runs intelligent solutions to solve real world problems. And why we are currently using such intelligent solutions too much? Because they are providing improved effectiveness and efficiency in especially real-world problems. As you know, the history of the humankind is with all lots of discoveries and inventions, and all of them have been done because of improving effectiveness and efficiency, and also trying to find some solutions for real world problems. As the more we developed more technology, the more we can get chance to understand more about the world, the nature, and we can become more adaptive to the changing conditions of the world. Of course, currently there is the issue of that COVID-19. So as you can see, there are lots of technology-based solutions trying to eliminate and trying to find some solutions for solving that issue, and also deriving some future solutions for the future possible pandemics, for example. And that's all we need. The humankind needs the technology, especially. Of course, we should, as the humankind, we should use the technology for the true purposes, not for bad decisions and for wars, especially. But the history has lots of bad scenarios and the events, unfortunately. But I hope the AI will be used for good purposes by the humankind for improving our standards for the daily life. And in that way, we can say that the AI is the science of the future, of course. And after the 21st century, we can also especially say that the AI is a very big science, which has some multidisciplinary connections with different fields. We cannot say, especially in maybe last years of and last half or quarter period of the 20th century, we can say that the AI was widely used for almost all fields. But after the start of the 21st century, we cannot say that that field, for example, that field is not the field where the AI is not used, for example, in even literature, in even music, and in even different fields of social science, because we already know that the AI is more associated with the engineering fields and the natural science. But in especially and in even social science, we can see lots of examples of the wide use of that scientific field. So we can certainly say that that field is a multidisciplinary science. And also we can say that the AI is an interface between human and the machine. For example, just think about the software and programs, computer programs. They are just the interface for making our computers to solve our problems by just using more computational resources and the careful maybe solution aspects of the digital systems and computers, of course. But when we think about AI, we can say that it's just the more advanced form of software or program codes, and the more advanced because it can learn, it can even learn and evolve itself. But still, it's an interface between human and machine. By just thinking about robotic systems, we can say that we cannot direct or give some orders to robotic systems by not using software, for example. But when we come to AI, we just make or give some short orders, and the rest of the actions are done by machine and the robotic system. So that explains why AI is also an interface between the human and the machine. And of course, we can say that if we can think about just software-based intelligent solutions, because the AI is not only the hardware component, as long as the hardware is also controlled by the software, of course, we can say that also in terms of software systems, it's an interface between the human or intelligent interface between the human and the computer system, maybe. And it's a very important aspect of the AI that it includes lots of mathematical and logical algorithms on the background. And also, especially, I know from our students and everybody I'm discussing with, the most important side of mathematical and logical side of the AI, and also beginners try to find more or easier way and more effective way to deal with that mathematical and logical side. Because when you talk about mathematics and logics, for example, everybody says that it's difficult. But actually, of course, if you want to be an advanced researcher or an engineer for building some AI algorithms or techniques, you may already know about advanced mathematics and logics. But when you are just a starter or beginner to learn about AI, you can just already use lots of resources we already know, and you will not forced to learn about the most advanced form of mathematics and logics. Just start, and after starting, you will understand what I'm talking about. And also, we can ask that if it's an utopia or dystopia for the future, and also if it's a technological risk and threat for the humankind, especially because, as you know, there are lots of discussions in that perspective. And everybody asked us if it will be or not cause of the extinction of the humankind. And so because of that, even scientific the committees are divided into two groups, which are respectively thinking that the AI has the potential of the harming humankind, harming humans and living organisms. And the other group thinks that it will not harm, it will just a useful technological tool. So we will see, as the AI is the product by the humankind, we should be following and managing carefully our product. So that such questions should be asked, answered, in time by just deriving some precautions and effective solutions to make that to feel everybody that the AI is not harmful for the humankind. It's just a useful and effective technological tool for solving our real world problems. And we cannot say that it's a science without human, because it's already our product, of course. And it's not evolving by its own efforts. As I've said in a few minutes, the field of AI is associated with lots of supportive technologies. We can just talk about computer and communication technologies, but we can also talk about electronics and data science maybe. And it's all supported by different fields. And also, the more the field of AI provides effective solutions for different fields, the more such fields, for example, biomedical or medical, just gives support, indirect support for the new developments, new advances that are triggering the field of AI to become bigger and bigger in time. And also we can, from that perspective, we can say that it's not a stable technology, at least for now. It's the future of humankind, also one of the most important, maybe the only important science of the future. So it's not a stable technology, but we should ask if we will need to stop it or not. But it's already depending on the efforts by the humankind. Because humankind, humans can be harmful for nature and for the contribution technological developments in bad ways, and use no form. That's that decision. Should be stopped or not. That decision should be, according to me, of course, should be given by the humankind's inside. Yes, when we come to make a definition for the field of AI, for the concept of AI, just come to Professor John McCarthy, who is the father of the concept of AI. Of course, there is Professor Alan Turing, who especially knows about that, for example, the use of electromechanical tools for solving the issue of the enigma by the Germans during the Second World War. You know, but the concept of AI was not used already during that period. But we can say that there is especially a very different perspective in the historical state of that field. But the main exact invention of the concept of the AI is actually started by the conference held in Dartmouth, USA, and John McCarthy, Professor John McCarthy, is the father of that concept. He says that AI is the science and engineering of making intelligent machines. And I also just given some definitions. For example, we can say that it's a subfield of the computer science in which research studies on simulating human thinking and behaviors are done. But we can not just talk about just human thinking. We can also talk about nature, about the animals. So just I'm making a small revision on that definition. And it's just explaining that definition is just explaining the state of the field under the computer science field. But when we come to make a more the dynamic definition, we can say that it's the act of achieving as much as possible of performing human thinking and behaviors, and especially, of course, the actions by animals or the other natural dynamics by computer-based systems. We can say that it's as much as possible, because none of the intelligent systems just run with very successful results at the rate of, for example, 100 persons. So if we get such system, we can just think that it's just, for example, it's just overfitting, maybe. It's just knowing more about the already given some previous the data of previous, for example, a problem. So we should just think about that the intelligent systems are the systems just giving as much as possible solutions for the real world problems. There are just some feedbacks saying that my voice is just having some problems. Let me to check that. I will just maybe just stop the presentation and let me adjust my audio. Can you hear me now? Is it better or not? I hope it's better. Just you can send me feedback. I'm continuing not to interrupt the presentation. Just give me the feedback, dear Professor Pandita and my friends from Turkey. If my voice is better now, I'm continuing. By just giving some feedback, you can just inform me. Okay. Anyway, these are the all definitions and also the perspective from different sides for the field of AI. It's not just only the concept, it's just also the field of the a subfield of the computer science. And also it's just for example, when we can see at some system running an AI solution on the background, we can say that it's just using AI solutions on the background, but also it's just the AI solution itself. So that's just a different perspective to explain what is AI or not. Anyway, we have lots of subfields under the field of AI. In time, many different subfields have appeared under the field of AI. As you can see, there is the machine learning, there is the optimization and cybernetics maybe. And also we can maybe, when you search for the web, over the web, you can see lots of different types of definitions or classifications that were done for explaining the subfields of the AI. But we already know about and hearing already more about machine learning, for example. And also, of course, you are hearing about the deep learning. So we should ask that if the field of machine learning or the what's the difference between the field of machine learning and also AI. We should ask that first of all. By the way, when I am looking at my YouTube website, I'm just seeing myself. Can you see my presentation now or not? Just give me the feedback so I can just continue. I think it's already sharing my screen. Anyway. But in the YouTube, I'm just seeing my face, so let me to know if it is okay or not. Anyway, we should ask that what is the difference between the machine learning and the field of AI? For example, we can say that the machine learning it already has the concept of the or the word of the learning, as you can see. We can say that not every kind of artificial intelligence techniques is machine learning techniques also. We can say that the techniques with having, for example, learning sites, learning capabilities are associated with the subfield of machine learning. So not every technique of the AI, the field of AI is actually machine learning, but all kinds of machine learning techniques are also known as the artificial intelligence techniques, AI techniques. So we should just talk about how the machine learning and deep learning is currently done. I'm already shared my screen, but I will again make that. I hope you are now seeing my screen. Just give me feedback. Anyway, I'm continuing. The machine learning has the techniques which are using especially learning techniques, I've just said. There is also the optimization side, also cybernetics. For example, cybernetics is just the subfield where we are just running, for example, some solutions for making people to, for example, make their some eliminated components to be supported with some medical or electronical and mechanical based components. And also it's a field where the people are just developing some systems which can improve your, for example, sight. For example, there is some glasses which you can use for night vision, for example. And also the people with having or with having some disabilities in terms of seeing can use some cybernetics oriented systems which has some components located some cathodes or sensors over your brain and giving some signals to your eyes to see everywhere as like the everybody seeing in a natural way. So cybernetics is just associated with different fields such like mechanical engineering or electronics engineering and such fields are very associated with the field of cybernetics. And also we have the optimization. It's widely inspired from the nature, especially from birds, from swarms in the nature, from bees, maybe butterflies or other bugs, insects, for example. And it's not actually using the learning side of the machine learning and deep learning. It's just using some mathematical models to run some iterative solutions for finding the most optimum values for some unknown variables in your mathematical model. So we can just say that the machine and deep learning is one of the subfields of the AI field. And when we come to machine learning, we can see the deep learning, which has the most advanced forms of neural networks currently. It's just a more advanced form of machine learning, which can deal with more and bigger amount of the data. And it also has some already the effective components. I will explain them in my next slides. And when we come to optimization, we can say that there is the evolutionary algorithms, for example. They are just using some known concepts of the evolution theory to make some components which were successful in past iterations in the loop, to make them to be running for giving the chance to more successful generations to find the unknown values better way. When we come to making some schema by talking about or by expressing some more about the rules and the relations of the AI, we can say that, as you can see, the deep learning is the subfield of the machine learning and machine learning is the subfield of the AI. And we can say that there is the cybernetics here, there is the data mining here. Data mining is associated with the AI in terms of some known techniques, in terms of especially techniques with learning capabilities. We can say that the data mining is more oriented in the form and the way of the data, but the AI is the more something more popular perspective and explaining the way of the solutions by running, for example, inspirations from the nature, maybe. So it's the AI is the more general term used for the defining the intelligent systems. But data mining is the concept which is used for understanding the process operations, processing operations over the data. And also there are some different techniques in the data mining, and some of the techniques in AI is not associated with the data mining. So they both have some intersections and not very common and similar fields. And also we can see that there is the robotics, which is the very near the field to the AI field. And also there is the data processing, which is one of the most effective supportive components of AI. For example, when you want to make your intelligent systems to give more effective solutions for the already known problem, you just run some data processing, for example, image processing or signal processing, to make your input data better understandable, to provide better solution for your problem. It's not like the humankind. We just use some different sources to learn something about a specific topic, maybe while studying some subjects. And we just have some additional and alternative sources, such as books or other maybe papers and other things. And also we can maybe just be taking some private lessons from a teacher to understand more about a specific topic. So these are like all that data processing aspects of the technological components. And after that, we can learn more about the study, and we just turn to the AI side in that way. So the data processing is one of the most known, effective, supportive component of the AI. We just make some preprocessing over the data and make our AI system to be having more chance to give effective solutions for the target problem. Yes, when we come to machine and deep learning, as I've said before, it's very similar to the learning and studying style of us. For example, when you take some courses, you just receive some training and you just try to learn something about the target topic. It may be about mathematics or it may be about something different, so maybe AI, just for example, one of an alternative training way is my, maybe the current webinar, my webinar now I'm running, and you also just read some books and also search for something over the Google maybe, and just you just receive some training in the schools as yourself maybe, and as long as the there is the lifelong learning concept for everybody, the training is the actually the one of the real components of the life itself. So as similar to that, we just run training phases for machine and deep learning techniques, and we should say that at this point every types of machine and deep learning techniques has some phases of training, testing, and application. And in that way, we can say that, for example, the optimization algorithms or the techniques which have not machine or deep learning capabilities include not training and testing phases. Of course, you use some benchmark functions or benchmark problems to see if your algorithm or technique is effective on solving the target problem. But you do not run exactly a training phase and not test your system before having that system in the application side. But when we come to machine and deep learning sites, you should have some samples of data which is explaining some maybe past results or past solutions of the target problem. And as like courses or the lessons at the schools, you just have some training, have some training sessions according to that data, like the information in the books or the information or knowledge given by your teachers, maybe at the universities or schools. Even as the scientists and academicians, we are searching for different sources to learn something new and something changing in terms of AI or other topics, depending on our expertises in terms of your professors and us here. So it's all the training phase, which is just directing your technique to learn effectively about the target problem. But after that, you just run some testing over that system. For example, you just take some amount of the past samples to train your system, because you just use the known outputs to make your system more trained and optimized according to the target known results. But after that, you just again use the rest of the amount of the data to run a testing phase for your system. When you make your test for the system doesn't know about the results, but you already know, so you just compare if your system had been trained very well according to its responses to the test data. It's like the examinations you are just taking at your schools and universities. For example, when you want to go in Turkey to universities, you just take a specific examination, and according to your success in that examination, you just choose which university to go. And not only the university entrance examinations, in even your courses in your school or universities, you just go to lectures day by day or week by week, and at the end you just take visa or final examinations so that your professor or teacher can see if you have learned enough about the target course. So that's the exact testing phase for applied for especially machine and deep learning techniques. And after your technique has accomplished the testing phase, you just take your technique to be applied in real world cases. you just feel now that your technique can be taking in exact place in the nature, in the real environment. So you just feel maybe okay that my system will be solving all types of that problems because I already trained it well and it already gave successful results for the testing. So it passed just testing. So it can be used in real applications. That's the way of the machine learning and deep learning. But of course, you already have some issues as we learning something. We already have issues in a real manner. When you learn something from a book, you just come with some new concepts maybe by looking at another book later. You already passed your or become successful in your course. And after a later, you may forget something about the problem, about the subject, or you may already know, or you may already needing to know more newer things about the target subject, for example. So we should just focus on how to train our system and which techniques or parameters to be used for effective training or making our system to be learning in every time. And also, we should give an exact true form of the model of the problem. We can say that in the real manner, in the real world, we just have some input values to solve something on the output side, for example. I just say that, for example, when you want to go shopping, you just take a look at to the weather, to the money, and to the distance, and to the maybe some rules according to, for example, locking down, maybe just or being closed, having closed down the shopping centers, maybe just directing your decision to not to go to shopping center, maybe. So we just have some input values, input parameters, having money state, maybe distance state, and also weather state. Maybe and maybe the need for buying something maybe from the shopping center that may affect your decision. And just by using that, for example, for the shopping center the problem, you just use that for inputs to make a decision on the one output, which is going or not going to the shopping center. And of course, you may have lots of inputs and lots of outputs at the same time. While having the same inputs, you may just have some different responses for the output side. But just focus on the input and the output balance at this point. You just place a solution in the middle of the input and output, and just that explains how we solve the real-world problems and how machine and deep learning, or of course, all types of artificial intelligence techniques, just try to find a solution for the output. You just locate some technique and some parameters, some values. You feed the component in the middle to find the balance between the known input and output side. That's the simple explanation for the learning side. But of course, when you come to optimization or other things, you just not run training, but just you just model your problem carefully and just locate your solution, and it doesn't need maybe the training phase. It just gives some results according to your input and output balance. That's all the exact way to make some solutions for some input parameters. And sometimes you don't know about the output, maybe you just run some different techniques to make the inputs separated into some groups to make your output visible. I will explain them in my next slides. For example, when we talk about the machine learning, we know the very famous machine learning and my favorite one, artificial neural networks. It's just inspired from the working mechanism of the human brain. For example, when I ask if you can remember what you have eaten 15 years ago, you cannot remember exactly that. But if you have maybe having a birthday or experienced some bad or good and positive or negative events in the that date in 15 years ago, for example, you may just remember something about that event. And also while you are studying your courses or lessons, you just read some books and make some electrical connections among some natural neurons in your brain. That explains why we remember something more the more we studied or the more we talk about. When you not study your subject or your course anymore, you just forget everything in time. But when you just try to look at to the books in your maybe high school from your high school or the past from the past times, for example, you just remember something in a blurring way. But when you just focus on more reading about that, you just improve the electrical states of the associated neurons to remember something more. And if you, for example, read the more about the pages and the other factors, affecting factors, the style of the book, the subjects explained in different pages, the more you read, the more you can just not learn about them. You just make some, how can I say, storage for the information. So that explains the overfitting of the machine learning. When your system can give effective results for the training data but not for the testing data, you may just say that it's not successful. It's just make the storage of the information of the training data. So that's very similar to the way of the our brain. So the artificial neural networks has the artificial neuron cell, which we can call as the perceptron. Also, it has the way of the having the different weights of the information, and in that way you just understand which information is more important or have more dominance according to other input values. So in that way you just try to make your technique to be learned about the target topic, the target problem maybe, by just optimizing these values. You can see there is the there are five neurons at the left side. This is the input layer, which means the input state, input parameters. And on the right side, you can see two neurons, which is the output layer, which means the output. So you just, for example, for the shopping center problem, you just locate the money state here. You just locate the for example, the distance state here, you just locate the weather state here, and you just locate the needs you have or not, the state of that needs on here. And after that, you can just have one neuron, one perceptron at the output layer, deciding that you can go to shopping center, which means one maybe, or which you cannot go to shopping center, which means zero. For example, or you can also have two decisions, maybe one of them may be going to shopping center and one of them may be going to maybe a small market near to your home maybe. So you just get two different decisions which is directed according to different values of the input state. And in the middle, as you can see, there are still some perceptrons. And we can just increase their numbers by locating additional layers, which are called as hidden layers. So that's when you have some more complex problems, they are just used for making your problem to be solved more effectively by the artificial neural network. But it's just the issue that you should try to find the exact number of hidden neurons, hidden layers, sorry, and the total number of neurons or perceptrons in each layer, hidden layer maybe, because it may be changed, that the tree value of that neurons doesn't mean it's associated with the input or output. Already there are some equations in some papers that explaining that when you use blah blah number of inputs and blah blah number of outputs, you should use blah blah number of layers and neurons in each of them. But that's not proved very well enough, I think. So that's the way of the optimizing your neural network structure. But at this point, the learning mechanism is done by using some specific algorithms, which can change the values of the weights according to each different input and output value. When your technique neural network is learning something about the target problem, you just feed the system by just giving some inputs and having some output, as you can see, by using summing the weighted each input. You just take your summed value throughout the function, and you just get an output, and that output may be a weighted input to the next neuron, maybe. When you have the output layer, that's the just having the exact output, of course. But according to that output, you just find the error between your obtained value and the desired value according to your training data. And according to the difference value, you just optimize, change each of the weights on all of these connections. And after that, you just feed the system with new training data. You may just think about an database structure, row by row, column by column. You may just have some input columns, and after that, one column for the output, and you just have maybe 200 of different states for each of them, corresponds to different decisions maybe on your problem. So by using each of row, you just optimize your weight. Of course, in each new data, in each new row, your weight values have just already updated in the previous learning mechanism, learning algorithms phase, for example. So according to that, you just run your model, maybe some determined iterations, or just by looking at the difference between the desired value and the obtained value. And according to that, you can just say that we have reached to the maximum number of iterations, loops, or you can say that the error is very small, so our model seems to be learned enough about the target problem. So that's the way of the machine learning and the neural networks. And just think about that, it's already same and similar in terms of different machine learning techniques, in decision trees or Bayesian neural learning or support vector machines. You just adjust or optimize some different parameters in some different sides of the technique. It's like the real life. You just have some experience by just solving some problems, and just by doing that, you just optimize something which is associated with the experience maybe, and you just learn more things about the solved problems, and you just learn how to act according to feature states for the same or similar problem. It's just similar in the machine and deep learning. And when we come to deep learning, as I've said, it's the more advanced form of neural networks, because it's already have some neural networks which have not only inputs hidden and output layers, but it already have some different neural networks which have some layers which have the capability of making some specific operations, not always using the way of the summing the weighted inputs and going, taking them through to function only. They just use different functions. So we have different types of layers in such deep learning techniques. As you can see, that's a sample for the CNN, convolutional neural network, which is very famous for especially image, the successful results for the image data. But that doesn't mean it can be used only for image data. You are all free to use for different types of problems. But the exact thing is the making the analyze over the data in a deeper way and in a more careful way. That means, for example, when you just run a machine learning and neural network, you should just make some feature extraction, which means the data processing, for example. You already run data processing for the deep learning, of course, but the deep learning actually has its own feature extraction phases. So making the exact solution only one single component to solve your problem, and making your maybe efforts to not to be divided into different phases like that feature extraction, pre-processing, I mean, and also classification and also output maybe. So that feature extraction may be done yourself or other image processing or signal processing or other maybe data mining oriented techniques or traditional techniques of mathematics maybe, or maybe just some statistical methods to lower the dimension of your data so that the machine learning technique can give effective solutions for the target problem. But when we come to deep learning, you already have the power of the feature extraction inside the model itself. And also there is not that only way of having that deep learning. We also have the deep belief networks. We also have the long short term memory. For example, long short term memory gives the advantage of storing some past known data inside your neural network, which means like a neural network having some data storage mechanism. And so in that way, you just solve some problems which have some effects from past states. So that, for example, when you maybe just think about the COVID-19, you have already need some past data to determine the future state better. So you can use LSTM, for example, long short term memory. Of course, you can use other techniques, but the long short term memory is more successful if your data has some connections according to changed data in time. If your changed data has some relations with the past and future data, you may just run the LSTM for better results. Anyway, when we come out of the machine learning, we come, for example, a general technique, which is fuzzy logic. By the way, I have just organized my presentation in that way because the beginner students can start from learning the neural networks and also by learning about the fuzzy logic. After a while, you will determine the exact way, I think. Also, you can start from the genetic algorithms. I will explain now. And the fuzzy logic is not the machine learning technique. It has just some rules on the background, and it's associated with the fuzzy theory by the professor Lütfali Askerzadeh from Azerbaijan. He says that as like the computer system, the decisions or the behaviors in the real life is not depending on the decisions with just a binary mode. He says that every value has some values with some fuzzy values changing from white to black mode, for example. So that's something like that. For example, when we just say one of our friends to close the window, we may just say that close the window a little more. But we cannot say that close the window or just open the window. That is the not the middle value in that both sides, for example. Or by just controlling the water, the temperature of the water, we may just say that make it a little warmer, for example. We just use some fuzzy values, some fuzzy, which I mean fuzzy definitions for determining the values of each different parameters. We cannot force our computers to have different states, different if-then else structure, for example, for every angle of the opening and closing state of the window, for example. It's even has in real number values, it has even has the, for example, infinite number of different states. So we just use the fuzzy theory and we just use the fuzzy logic structure. As you can see, one value may be associated with members of the different states, for example, here. And so fuzzy logic is widely used for especially controlling problems. And when we come to optimization, we know the genetic algorithms. You can also start from that. As I've said, you just run a mathematical model for your problem and just you just use some evolutionary theory parameters to make your each of components adjust to give better results or better the value predictions for the unknown variables in your target function model function or equation model for the target problem. That means optimization is not the machine learning again, but we just model some equations, which is explaining, for example, something like that, just calculating how much grade or point you should get from the final examination to pass the course, for example, because you already know about the past grades and you just focus on or will be taking the final examination. So you just try to find the exact the optimum, the minimum value for the unknown variable in your problem, in your equation. It's something like that. But in the real life, you just have maybe 100 unknown variable with more complicated equations. So the traditional mathematics is not very successful in finding optimum values for such parameters. So the AI-based optimization, genetic algorithms, artificial bee colony or particle swarm optimization or other techniques are very successful by just using some heuristic methods, by just using some random values and not quarantining, making or proving that the result is the value that the exact solution for the problem, but just finding some near values, which means you can just use them to solve your problem by locating your unknown variables with the optimum values. Anyway, when you come to AI in the present state, we can see that, as I've said already, there is the optimization. Actually, the machine and deep learning is the optimization. And by running them, also you just use pattern recognition, which means you just derive some hidden information from the known problems, maybe. And already everything is almost related to prediction, which means, for example, medical diagnosis is the prediction, false diagnosis is the prediction, and using some time series of economical data to find out how the economical data will be like in the future is means prediction, of course. And you use adaptive control for solving problems that brings us to especially fuzzy logic. And information discovery is very important, for example, in COVID-19 and in the past time period, AI is already used for some finding some working solutions, possible solutions, of course, and which means that the information discovery and maybe it's already used in the COVID-19 perspective, and that means the discovery of the information, which means finding an information which is not known before, but discovered by the artificial intelligence techniques. And when we come to present applications of such system, as I've said, you just run some feature extraction, and after that you just run some training, testing and application, and also direct or indirect use depending on your problem by using your artificial intelligence based techniques. And you already think about deep learning, you already run your technique because it has own feature extraction phases to training and testing itself and running it in application in terms of direct or indirect use. I mean, for example, when you solve maybe some parameters of the building, for example, rising a building, you just run a hybrid system or the systems with some modular structure to predict some values by using some deep learning site, and also finding some optimum values by using not learning, machine learning, deep learning site, but by just using genetic algorithms, which means optimization problem. And after that, by just combining all of these values, you just reach to the exact solution. Because sometimes you don't need the exact using the maybe deep learning for finding more deeper solutions for your problem. Because some techniques are already successful for finding the optimum or the successful value. And that depends on the experience, of course. That depends on the experience and understanding the details of the systems. Anyway, I'm speeding up now in order not to spend more time and take your time, sorry. I will improve, speed up. If you have any questions in terms of any slides or information, just ask me at the end. And as I've said, we have already the input-output state for the problems. But when you come to the data type, sometimes you just know input and output. But sometimes you know only input, for example. You don't have any idea about which outputs we already have for the past samples. Just think about some student grades, for example. You have some student grades, and also you have some letter grades for these grades, visa and final examination you have as the input, and the output, you already have some letter grades, which means you can use supervised classification technique to train your machine on deep learning technique to find the exact connection between the letter grades and the visa and final examinations. That means classification. And you already know input and the associated outputs from the past states, past results. But when you have some values, for example, predicting the house prices, maybe it's just real values and or natural values, which you cannot say that it's a good house, middle house, bad house, for example, or medium house, or maybe it's not related to classification, but it already has some inputs and output values, which are some past house prices. You just come to the supervised learning, but that time you can come to the regression, for example. For classification, you just say that A, B, C, or you have the COVID-19 positive, or you have the COVID-19 negative, maybe, for medical diagnosis, for example. But when you come to the regression, you just say or talk about numbers. So that's the supervised learning, but it can be classification or regression. So that means supervised equals to classification and also regression, depending on to which types of output we are seeking for. And when you have only input, not output, for example, somebody comes up and gives you some visa and final examinations from past students, but doesn't say that we don't know about the letter grades at the output, but you can just maybe group that visa and final examinations into 5 different groups maybe. And that brings us to the unsupervised learning, which means also clustering. We just try to find some similarities among the input data and just make them grouped into 5 different clusters, for example. And after that, we just have the trained system, and so that system can give effective responses for the that problem, having no output in the past, but only having input from the past. And the most important, maybe, types of the learning state is the reinforcement learning. That's not associated, actually, the knowledge rules. That's another data type, another component. I hope that doesn't make you confused, feel you confused. The knowledge and rules is just for example, for the fuzzy logic or knowledge-based systems. So that's another data type. You just have your input and output balance according to some rules. By having that blah blah and having that, then the result is blah blah, for example. That's the knowledge, that's the rule, that's another topic which we may run another webinar even. And anyway, the reinforcement learning is the one of the most important, maybe the learning style of the machine and deep learning, because you just give some feedback to your system, to your machine or deep learning based system, and it's just associated with the experience from the real life. According to given feedback, your system can just evolve its actions by having positive or negative feedbacks, or having some rewards or negative values according to the actions. So everybody is asking that in the future, which types of machine learning or deep learning systems will be alive, and which types of different feedbacks should be giving so that the system will not give some harmful or dangerous actions in the future. That's very blurred the future, because we don't know even exact some mathematical models to understand more about the future, because as like the human, because everybody was somehow a baby in the past, but when you have some bad people around you, your personality may become bad, or according to the people around you, according to your family, your friends, you learn more about the ethics, the more about something maybe, and you become maybe a doctor or engineer or something like that. So that's all about the reinforcements, the feedback, and the real life is actually also associated with that. The experience is also associated with that. And when we come to semi-supervised learning, it's just a combination of that data type. Some of data has the output, some of them doesn't have, so we just run the semi-supervised learning. When we come to optimization out of the machine and deep learning, we have just have only one equation maybe, so that means single objective. And if we have more than one equation, that means multi-objective. And according to the values, for example, if you want to get some real values for your unknown variables, you just run the continuous optimization. And if you have, for example, that is the continuous optimization, you just model your problem according to that. That's not machine on deep learning, but intelligent optimization, which means genetic algorithms, blah, blah. And when you come to the combinatorial optimization, you just have some already known possible solutions, but you just find the exact routing along the possible solutions. Just think about the routing problems or the traveling salesman problem, or you just have a limited bag to carry some products, for example, and you just try to find the each number of each component, each product to carry the most expensive combinations of the products, so that you can just sell more when you go to a city, another place, for example. So that's again a combinatorial optimization problem. And when we come to the future of AI, we should ask that the AI, how the AI is in daily life will be like, for example. Or in the future, we can think that we will already have unmanned machines, and we will already have some robotic assistants, not yet maybe like the science fiction movies, but the future is changed according to the AI systems and according to the way of the AI, which is affecting too much our future. So we can just think about some jobs, for example. New jobs will be arising. For example, some research says that the even millennial generations, and also some generations which was born at the end of the 20th century doesn't already know which jobs you will have in the future. Their job is actually, especially for the generations of millennials, which means which was born in after 2000, I mean, they we have not yet their jobs. For example, some research says that they will have totally new jobs in the future. And these jobs actually will be some evolved jobs for now. You may already know some about some old jobs which were, are not alive now, but they were sometimes evolved into something different, something like that. For example, the statistical, it's now called as more the data science. Data science is not change the statistics with the change name, but it's the new form of the statistics. So data science just runs more about the statistics and focused on more about the data and numbers. So that's a new name, new generated name, for example. And when we talk about the jobs, current jobs, if your jobs is has some routines in it, in that, think about just iterate systems or just some actions which in your job you have just performing in a routine, your job will be probably computerized by the computers, and which means the AI, because the AI is very powerful in making and ensuring achieving the operations and the performance in terms of routines. It's careful it has more research according to us, because we, as the humankind, we are even affected by different environmental factors or psychological factors maybe. So the routines or the jobs having the routines inside that will be more affected or most likely to be computerized by the AI. But when we talk about psychological side, sorry, and maybe something related to the how can I say, the insight of the humankind, not physical or the which means the psychological side, I mean, so such jobs will not be least likely to be computerized by the computer systems and also especially AI. For example, we can talk about recreational therapists and personal assistants maybe, and also maybe I don't know if every job names are same in different countries, but the jobs with having more focus on the humankind and the psychological side of the human and the characteristics of each human, which means the something chaotic in terms of understanding the target problem, will be least likely to be computerized. When we talk about different jobs, we can see such rates, percentage or probability of automation, for example. Maybe, for example, bartenders have the a remarkable percentage. Loan officers or retail salespersons have already have a bigger percentage according to musicians, singers or lawyers, for example. But we already know some samples of different AI systems associated with the lawyers' jobs or musicians or singers. But the percentage is just low, we can say it's like that. And in also especially different jobs, the rates are also changed depending on the subfields of such jobs. For example, finance jobs also have some different types of different jobs which have less or more percentage of being automated by the AI. And when we come to the future of AI, by taking steps, some near future or to far future, we can say is that we are currently experiencing the artificial narrow intelligence, which means execute specific focused tasks without ability to self-expand functionality. And that means jobs are enhanced in that way. And when we came to the about, for example, 2040, we may probably get the artificial general intelligence, which is a new concept, and that means it can just solve different problems depending on the reasons or some capabilities of using the intelligence to find the exact solution, not provided by us the solution, but finding the solution and running the solution. Such systems will be called as artificial general intelligence. That's something like that. For example, you will give the IKEA paper to the system. The system will read the manual to how to build up the maybe the chair or the table. And after reading that, it will build the table itself. Not we will be giving the orders how to model or how to build up the table. We can use already artificial neural intelligence for that. But artificial general intelligence will use to solve the solution even for the target problem. And after that, there is the artificial super intelligence, which is soon after the AGI, maybe 2050, maybe. And that's introduced by Nick Bostrom, Professor Nick Bostrom from Oxford University. And it says that it outperforms humans, helping to achieve social or the general objectives, which are very specific for the humankind. And that's also a very big discussed concept, that it will be threatening the humankind or being a negative or having a negative results for the future of the humankind. You can follow these concepts. And also we have the ambient intelligence for a, actually that's not a very new concept, but the concept which is gaining more importance day by day with thanks to especially IoT systems maybe. That means you will already surrounded by some artificial intelligence systems which just control the well-being of your surrounding, for example. You can see an example of that system. It's just a combined and a system with different components, which is controlling the different size of the whole house, for example, and that means ambient intelligence. As I've explained about the artificial general intelligence, and the road to the artificial general intelligence is something like that. For example, we just may call the narrow intelligence, narrow artificial intelligence, as the weak AI. And after that, the weak AI will be probably get more and more improvements in time. And you can see that it's just started from the use of functions, but after that, using some more complicated models of problem solutions. And after that, just being close to the thinking and acting style of the humankind. And after that, it will reach to the strong AI side, which means the general intelligence, and which means maybe will be or called as the super intelligence after that. It's understand about abstract concepts, explain why, be creative like children, tell right from wrong, and have emotions, which you know very hard to see from already known artificial intelligence systems. And that's all of these are very widely discussed things, because emotions, ethics, and other things which are very abstract and not very well modeled or understood by even humankind will be also a big issue and problem for the future of the AI. As we have not already known very well about them, how we will be having such systems in the future? That's a very important question. And after that, there is the explainable artificial intelligence. That's also a very popular subject nowadays. When you run some AI systems, you just run the system, but you just run the black box models, which means you cannot ask to the system at the results, why did you do that, why not something else, and when do you succeed, and just you should just trust to the system by not asking questions, and that's not making sense, as you know. And by using the explainable artificial intelligence, researchers just take some layers or some patterns to make our systems to explain something about the solution process. We just use some additional, maybe middle layers between the input and output, we can say that. And we call that as the XAI, explainable artificial intelligence. And when we ask, for example, when you ask to the doctor how you reach to that diagnosis, if you ask such question, the doctor can say that I have used some blah blah things and I have just reached to that decision. And in that way, we will just we can just enable such artificial intelligence systems to explain what have been done around the solution process or during the solution process. And that takes us to the explainable artificial intelligence. And I am coming to the end. Thank you very much for your patience, by the way. I hope that doesn't make you feel bored, but if that makes your brain to, just with something like a Stack Overflow, and that's good. Don't worry. When you just search for something more after my webinar, you will just have more comfortable about learning the current and future state of the AI, and you will just find your way, I believe. And when we come to open problems, we can say that there will be new AI techniques. It's just already the way of the field, that AI, and we will having more use of hybrid models, which means use of traditional or AI systems, or just using more than only one AI systems to run more advanced systems for solving multi disease diagnosis, maybe, for example, or solving at the same time more than one problems at the same time by using hybrid models, or just improving the performance of your system by just using some supportive components such as image processing or other things. Or maybe you can just think about that because, or since the machine learning is actually optimization, you can just run some genetic algorithms or some other intelligent optimization algorithms to make your training phase of your model better, for example. That's also, again, an hybrid model approach. And also choosing true parameter values training data sets will always be a big problem. And solving new problems, of course, for example, think about COVID-19. And also use of robotics. We already know about traditional robotics, but there is the other side, soft robotics, which is very remarkable, because when you use soft robotics, you just make robotics reaching to narrow or size of the problem, which cannot be reached by traditional or hard robotics. For example, you just use some soft components, silicon or similar components, to make your robotic system more flexible. And that brings a more multidisciplinary side by taking or considering material engineering or chemistry engineering, maybe, and also biomedical or medical. So that's important. And also how to train AI correctly, how to get effective machine learning systems, which types of supportive technologies are also will be important in the future. And also openness in AI is very critical, because for example, Elon Musk thinks that the AI should be open, and because of that, he already established supported the company of called as OpenAI, because he thinks that the AI may be harmful if we cannot be able to see its source or have collaborative support to make future of AI safer, for example. And in contrast, Zuckerberg says that the AI will not be harmful. And there is a remarkable amount of people thinking about copyright issues and not accepting the being or having AI with open source codes or open structure, for example. And in the future, we will always be focusing on or dealing with the data, of course. Even now, everybody trying to collect some effective data to find out some effective solutions for COVID-19 or future possible pandemics, for example, by using Twitter, by using different types of, for example, image or image data, medical data, or different types of data, social data, maybe. They are all important for training good systems, training machine and deep learning systems, or just building some mathematical models by using some data, for especially maybe optimization side, not learning side maybe. And also ethical and safety oriented issues are important. Existential risks are important, because from the Cambridge University, there is the Center for the Existential Risk, for example, and they have already taken the AI in the existential risk classification. They just accept the AI as an existential risk by just having it in the same group or similar group near to nuclear weapons, biological weapons, and disasters or other things, for example. So that's important. And also in the future, people think that the most effective way of using AI will be something, a combination of biological and digital systems. For example, you can follow the computer brain-computer interface, maybe research. And in the future, people think that by just making connections to some maybe science fiction movies, such as Ghost Shell, maybe we will just supporting the biological components, maybe brains or other biological systems, or just we'll be having some support from them to build up more effective and more manually thinking systems with supported with especially computer-based components. And after that, I want to finish my presentation with some suggestions. For example, I want to say, especially to our valuable friends, students, I can say that do not just learn about the technical side of the AI, but also try to learn about philosophy of AI and its essentials. That will be having or giving you the exact idea to how to learn new kinds of AI systems in the future. And also try to learn algorithmic details of AI techniques, for example, by just starting from the neural networks, from the fuzzy logic or genetic algorithms I have just explained in that webinar. I mean that what I mean from that sentence. I mean that do not just focus on just using ready libraries or ready components from, for example, Python programming language. Already you will use ready components or libraries, but in order to understand more about logical structure, logical background, and more about the AI technique, just try to write it with some pure code, which means you can already use the Python, of course, but I also suggest using C programming language or Java, for example, and also there is the Julia, for example, rising fast following the Python, but just not try to not use ready libraries. Just use exact code to understand how your target technique is working, and learn some about supportive technologies. Of course, learn about IoT, and by using that, learn about that Raspberry Pi systems or other things. Maybe Arduino and other things, variables, but by just learning about something about such systems, you will already learn also something in a parallel site, AI, about something AI, regarding to AI, and also learn about some data science statistics that may be important. Learn some about mathematics and logics. Some simple mathematics and logics will be effective in the first step, but after that, while you are learning more about details of the algorithms, you will already learn about some mathematical, some more advanced mathematical sides. But if you want to be the exact expert of building new kinds of AI systems, you may be needing more about the mathematics and logics, as I said at the start of my presentation. And also choose some soft fields to working. I am working in different sites. My PhD is from optimization, and I'm also working, maybe, for example, nowadays in deep learning for biomedical, and also I'm focused on the AI safety, which means using some hacking methods or some defensive or attacking methods to get safe systems, for example. But you can find a better way to determine some soft fields at the first. I like or I love to work with the AI, so that I'm focused on different types of subfields. But maybe just keeping that number at around 2 or 3, you can just focus on at the same time to the optimization side, maybe to the fuzzy logic side, controlling side, and to the maybe deep learning side. I want to explain that from that sentence. And also join to the events, webinars such like that, and follow the other webinar sessions as realized by the Jayavant Institute of Management Studies. And also join to different training programs. There are lots of massive online learning environments. You can take some online courses, and also read about AI. There are lots of news, blogs, videos, newsletters, and there are also scientific publications you can follow. Google Scholar of ResearchGate or other environments to academia, maybe Mendeley, maybe to get some more about the publications. And you already have, that generation already have more resources to understand more about AI. So just have that advantage of that opportunity. That's not similar in my time and in the time of my professors, maybe. So just enjoy that opportunities. But of course, that opportunity has some chaotic style. Just try to be focused on some specific sources, important sources, to move step by step, not in a fast way, but not in a very slow way, but at an optimum state. And also, you can follow famous scientists. There is the Nick Bostrom, as I've said. There is Kurzweil. There is Stuart Armstrong. There are many other professors specifically working in different subfields. I don't know if I am famous or not, but you can also follow me if you desire. But there are many, many more famous and big scientists around the world. So you can follow them. And you can learn something about what they are doing, because such scientists just follow the exact what is currently done or what will be currently done with their valuable predictions. So you can also follow such famous scientists. Yes, thank you very much for listening my presentation. I hope I have opened a wide enough view for understanding what is the AI, what is its present state in terms of different subfields, especially by maybe thinking about machine learning and deep learning side. Also, especially learning about its possible near and far future in order to be capable of having necessary knowledge to have your research orientation more focused on the field of AI. Yes, thank you very much. In order to have the questions in a better way, I'm just stopping my screen share. Anybody wanting me to share my presentation, you can just send a mail to my mail address. Just you can send to the Gmail address, because I think my institutional email address just received some messages in spam or in late time or in a delay. So you can just follow my that personal mail address. I already talked about my website. You can also just follow that. So your questions are all welcome. Thank you very much. I will take
Thank you.
Leave comments. Yeah, sure, Professor Pandita.
Thanks, sir, for your valuable inputs. Now we will be going for a question and answer session.
Yes.
If any questions, please you can use the chat option.
Yeah, comments, I will just yes. Also look at to the past comments. I don't see any questions. So your questions are all welcome, dear friends. You are welcome, dear friends. If you have no questions for now, you can already send my mail later. If you have any more questions later in the following days, in the next periods, you are all welcome. There is no problem, but some of good questions could be great to have now. Let's see. Oh, a general question for you, dear professor, the topics of tomorrow's session. Yes, I will provide, or I can provide the PPT file. I don't know if you are asking that to professor, but in terms in myself, I can share them by maybe, but I can send that to the professor so they can share with the listeners by looking at the feedback form maybe, or if you can reach to my personal mail address, I can also send it in a private message, of course. And Utkarsha has just asked that what is the use of AI in electrical engineering, and is AI is used in electric vehicle, Kranti just asks. Yeah, in, for example, electrical engineering, we can just talk about that. For example, you just use that in, for example, control problems, as I have explained in the fuzzy logic side. And also, you may just make some predictions in terms of, for example, early fault diagnosis of electrical systems, so that you get the exact time of the when some components of your electrical system will be broken. You can use just machine learning or deep learning for that. And also you can just use control mechanisms of the fuzzy logic to make an adaptive controlled electrical system, which is optimized according to very small amount of time, by not just using the control of the humankind, by just using an autonomous system, which is making decisions itself and running of your electrical system, to maybe spend less electricity and become more stable in terms of solving solutions. Okay, in that way you can use that. There is a difference between classification and clustering, dear Purva. As I've said in my presentation, you have input and output data at the same time for making classification. You already have the results for the already known input samples from the past. But when you talk about classification, your results just have some strict classes between them, which means, for example, your student letter grades maybe, or the value of the maybe houses, it's good, expensive, or low price, maybe something like that. But if you use exact real value, number value, you just come to the regression. And the clustering is used for the problems having no idea about past outputs of past samples. So there is the output side difference for the classification and the clustering. By using clustering, you just find some similarities in the past sample. And after that, you just come to the understanding which types of inputs come to the different types of outputs. You just should use the clustering to make some groups and so that you can give the true outputs for the new states. And in electrical vehicle, for the question by Kranti, electrical vehicles, the AI is used, of course. It's my answers for the question by the Utkarsha are still same for that. But if you think about the unmanned vehicles, for example, you can just use AI to make some autonomous electrical vehicle, for example. And also you can use AI to, when we talk about electricity, you can just use AI to make the spending of the electricity optimized, for example. And you just run AI to make some predictions or optimizations for the energy consumption, maybe. Yes, we can just use for that.
We have a question. Can AI replace in academic classes?
Sorry, can you ask again, dear professor?
Can artificial intelligence replace in academic classes?
That's a very remarkable question. As long as the academic lectures are depending on giving some specific topics and explaining something autonomously to the target students, to the massive target students, and as long as the intelligence systems can adapt themselves according to your past grades, to your past performance over the, for example, web environment or over the some physical maybe performance evaluation aspects, you can run AI systems in the academic environment or school environment. But when you come to the psychological side of students, which means you know the humankind or the teachers or the professors also focus on the psychological side of students, according to students' psychological sides, you can change your mind on explaining something or just focus some specific students to re-explain some concepts to directly to them, for example. But as long as the AI cannot still understand about the psychological state, as long as we have not ready something modeling for the psychology for the humankind, I can explain something like that. It can take part partly by with us collaborative work with the teachers, as we are doing in online maybe webinars, for example, something like a blended learning. I mean, in the near future, that can be something like that. But the future is still unclear, of course. But if that psychological side can be solved, then the teachers, professors, maybe remote, of course, I can say like that. And dear professor.
I have one more question. Any sure. Method for model selection based on the data?
Sorry, can you?
Any method for model selection based on the data? Model selection.
Model selection. You mean technique, selection of technique using decision tree.
Yes.
Correct. According to data, if your data has some, for example, connections between the input to output, if you cannot say exactly certain connections, you have not capable of making that, you can just run some black box techniques such as neural networks maybe. But at least as long as you can have just some data, some input data and output data connection, which just you can use human efforts, but you just if you just have need more time to realize that in order to run a more effective way of running less time of the AI system, you may just use maybe decision trees or some more rule-based systems such as fuzzy logic. But we cannot say that that such data is for only neural networks, but that data is just for fuzzy logic. We cannot say that. But according to my experience, especially at least, as long as your or the more your problem is complicated, the more you will be needing the neural networks or machine learning side. And the more big amount, complex amount of data you get, the more you need use of deep learning, especially for nowadays. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Is Java useful for AI and machine learning?
Yeah, it's useful. Actually, the object-oriented programming is useful. You can follow the languages with object-oriented programming because you can model the AI techniques easily by using object-oriented programming languages, which brings us to the Java, C++ and Python, of course, and of course you will be dealing with more detailed coding like structuring classes and other components of your model of your the model of your techniques, but it will be very useful. And I know there are lots of different libraries effectively used in Java. As the Python is very popular nowadays, but the Java is also has its own power itself.
So one more question. Can AI use in agriculture?
Yes, of course. In agriculture, you can use AI. For example, there are lots of different examples of videos. You can just search for, how can I say, Netherlands or Holland. I remember there are some drone and some unmanned vehicle-based agriculture solutions used by a farmer, for example, in the Netherlands. You can just search for with some keywords, and if you use the AI and agriculture keywords over the web, you will reach to different systems, for example, predicting the health state, future health state of your plants, and predicting appropriate sites of your environment to locate some seeds for better production in the future. And there are some already different AI-based systems just by taking some photos and some data from sensors to build up some IoT-oriented systems to make well-being, future well-being of your agricultural environment. Of course, you can also use some predictive methods to run some information discovery, which means you can just maybe just I'm thinking in my style the professors from agricultural site maybe have more deeper idea about such solutions, but you can just derive new information about which types of vegetables and fruits and plants can be combined in my environment to make blah blah production in the future and to make a better agricultural solution which is stable, for example. And also you can just use that AI systems for sustainability, of course, for clean energy for your agricultural environment. And that's very popular subject. I also suggest to make some research about that. And just think about if your field needs something needing to be predicted and something to be maybe having some future ideas or having some new models of combined information. Just think about that. If your field have such problem formulations, or can be you can have some such formulations, then you can all use the AI techniques for better solutions. I can just briefly say that that's similar and that's same for even education, even agricultural, even electrical engineering, even medical, especially because COVID-19, just think about that. It's an unclear future. We are just talking about unclear states. We are just trying to predict something. We are just trying to make some predictions from the past, or we are just trying to derive some new information and control something. So that brings us to the AI solutions directly.
So one more question.
Yeah.
Machine learning frameworks for approaching the prediction application in biomedical.
Actually, I don't know direct name of the framework for writing codes for directly to the biomedical, but I suggest using Python. As you know, there are lots of scikit-learn, scikit-learn, I can spell like that. That's a very important library. There is also, of course, TensorFlow for the Python. You can use that. You are all free to use the Colab by Google. It's very effective environment to learn something fast by not needing any ready technological components such as computers or other things. And they have already have known some samples on especially biomedical data sets. I don't know exactly if somebody have come up with some specific frameworks for biomedical engineering, because generally AI is flexible and ready frameworks are already used in medical, biomedical and other things, especially for time series prediction or image processing sites or image database solutions. So you are all free to use such Python solutions. And also there are for C Sharp or Java, Aforge, I can say that Aforge.net is effective. There are lots of frameworks. I remember just the Python sites for now, but just write AI and framework keywords over the Google. So you will all have different types of frameworks targeting directly, for example, Java or Python, or maybe different programming languages that are not too much popular like the other ones, but you will already reaching to many different types of frameworks. Yeah.
So one more question: are terminators made by artificial intelligence?
Sorry, can you repeat, dear professor?
Are terminators made by artificial intelligence?
Terminators. Yeah, and it's in theoretical in theoretical side, it's possible. It's possible in theoretical side, but in practical side, in practical manner, the AI needs more and more and more use of technology to build up such things. In theoretical side, if the humankind cannot have some policies and careful control of such systems, the future of such systems, for example, super intelligence by Nick Bostrom explains that the future of such systems, the future of the super intelligence in the future may come up with some terminators, of course. But for currently, it's not too much possible in terms of practical manner. But if you think about theoretical sites, just taking time, I mean, and just depending on us. Everybody asking about that, but the question should be given by the humankind, especially. There are some researchers, for example, some research groups which try to make some policies to for the usage of AI by different countries. For example, they say that the AI shouldn't be used for building weapons, for example, not just like for attacking, but for even defending methods. The AI shouldn't be used for building weapons, they say that, for example. But I don't know, everybody will be trying to develop more and more things for such things, and that are exactly the outputs. Such outputs are the exactly maybe the the threats for the existence of the humankind. Yes.
So one more question. Can the scientific concepts used in movies come in use with the real lives and advancement of artificial intelligence?
You mean the ideas, the imagined ideas from the movies to build up AI? You mean?
Correct. Yes.
Yeah. There are some, of course, the AI is the imagined by the humankind. It's all related to us. And the movies are also, of course, the science fiction movies are related to us. So there are already some efforts to make something from the science fiction movies to real, to make real, like the flying cars, to other things. But I think that will be not very similar to the movies always. And also, of course, there are some different points. For example, in some movies, the movie makers are already using some theoretical and practical sides knowledge from the AI side, and to make their movies more realistic and more balanced according to the real side, for example. Always that's science fiction, but the fiction side is supported by the real science. So maybe it can be, but with some differences, the real objects maybe can be real from the science fiction movies, but there is a thin line between the impossible ones and the possible ones, I can say that.
Thank you, sir.
You are welcome.
Participants are requested to please fill the feedback form.
Yes.
If any questions, you can use the comment section.
Yes, and if I have any missed questions, because there were lots of comments, sorry for that. And you can send me via mail, or you can just send via feedback form later, or to professors, and they can direct to me. I'm all free to make that, of course. And I think for example, will someone be like Tony Stark with Jarvis? Maybe, I don't know. Elon Musk is also is known as something like Tony Stark, but that's also not in theoretical side possible, but in the practical side, there are more steps to be taken to make something like that real. Yeah. I will look at if there are different questions.
Neuralink is complete AI. One more question is Neuralink is complete AI.
Neuralink is complete
AI. Artificial intelligence.
Not exactly a direct complete of AI. It's something like that biological and digital systems formation, as I've said in my open problems. It's something like that, something like brain and computer interface. But we don't know if it day by day it's evolving and it's running day by day. So we don't know if they will be adding something AI inside that. For example, of course, it will be making something like the from the movie of Ghost Shell, but we don't know later. They will be adding some AI. I can remember some movie, but I cannot remember its name. But there was a movie. The AI was locating itself inside a man, and day by day, it was starting to control the human by making that man to use his legs and other arms and other components, because he had an accident, I remember. But later, the AI was using its mechanisms to control the men day by day. So I don't know if that will be evolved to that side. Yeah.
So one more question: which is the best course of artificial intelligence present at present?
From the web source, I think Abhijit is asking. I cannot give an exact name of a teacher, but you can follow the courses over the Udemy. But just focus on the feedbacks, comments by the other friends, because I'm not following each of them. But you may encounter with some known authors, some known teachers giving some courses over Udemy, and there is also edX. You may know there are some massive online enrollments from MIT site, and they will be already very effective to learn something about AI. But they may be in deeper side of technical state, so don't be afraid of such courses by reputable bigger institutions around the world. But you are all free to search over the web. You can search for essentials of AI, and to search for some courses combining writing some codes with the explaining essentials of the AI, not just using the codes only, not just explaining the theoretical side only, maybe just by combining all of them, because you may be paying for them, so, and your time will be valuable. But if you want to learn exact codes or exact theoretical sides, both of them are especially important. You can search over the books, over the web for the books, or the by using physical components such as hard copy books. And for the courses, for the online courses, just try to find such courses combining both sides. Okay.
Is AI replaces humans?
The automation is replacing humans, actually, but I don't. We cannot give a clear answer to that for now. It's just replacing our jobs and our tasks. But the more we use the technology, the more we connect to the digital world. The future may be depending on the AI replaced us, of course. But that's again possible in terms of theoretical side. And in practical side, there should be more efforts to make that possible. But the technology, the automation and the AI, the technology is replacing our tasks and jobs, which means we become lazier or uncomfortable in terms of natural life, maybe the life in the nature, I mean social life. So that's important. There are some more questions. Career opportunities, for example, you can follow data scientists opportunities, and in the future I think there will be some different opportunities such as AI experts and engineers itself. I already see some openings in such titles, such positions in different sites. But just focus on the data science also and the jobs with the title including AI sites, because there are some jobs titles, maybe, for example, they are saying that that's the programmer, but front-end programmer, for example, and then you just come up with everything including mobile programming and AI programming and blah blah. So be careful against them. Why artificial intelligence is better than other technology? Because it's flexible, it's having power from mathematical and logics, and it's associated, supported with electronics, data science, and many engineering fields. And the AI is actually the something like a simulation of the real life with engineering efforts. As the engineering fields are very remarkable, AI, and as the AI has the flexible solutions for every kind of problems, and it has already proved many successful results, it's better than many technology. But we cannot say that the future is only AI. The future is a combination of different technologies. Yes, we can say it like that. When we'll be able to self conscious artificial intelligence like Terminator? There are some attempts, yes, and which company is the best at AI area? You can follow maybe OpenAI, or in terms of company, maybe Elon Musk's company is maybe good, but everybody is very enrolled in such things. But I suggest you to follow the OpenAI maybe, and there is MIRI, Machine Intelligence Research Institute. There are lots of companies in Turkey, in around the world. And there are some attempts to make self-conscious AI, but there are many still many steps to be taken. Yes.
Sir, there are some few suggestions from the participants. Can you please share the PPT?
Yeah, how can we make that? I don't know, but if I can send you, dear professor, you can you share or?
Yeah, that will be okay. I will be sharing because I do have the mail IDs of all the candidates, registered candidates.
Okay, okay. I will send to Professor Pandita, dear friends, so he will share it because he has already all of mails of the listeners. So that's a better and the faster way, I think.
Thank you so much
for all great feedbacks, by the way. And just do not forget to follow the other webinar sessions in the following days. And thank you very much for that kind invitation by professors and by the GSPM's JISM, if I'm not saying it wrong, and hope to be again taking place in similar webinars in the future. Yes.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of GSPM's Jayavanth Institute of Management Studies, Pune,
yes.
I would like to extend my deep and sincere thanks to our esteemed speaker for the day. Thank you, sir, for sharing your wonderful information about artificial intelligence, its subfields, its problems, and future of artificial intelligence. We look forward for your guidance and association in future as well. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. See you again, and have a nice day, have a nice evening. I will be following the activities by you, by your institution, and I wish all the best in terms of that academic works, and I wish all the best around the world for the listeners, for the professors, for the colleagues listen to me from different countries, different institutions, to be safe and to be healthy in the period of that COVID-19, and just do not forget about the having the advantage of that time period by improving your knowledge. My words are for especially the students, but I would like to thank to all listeners, including professors, colleagues, and valuable students, friends. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks.
Thank you. See you again. Bye-bye.